Greetings, sir and sirettes, and welcome back to From the Depths with me, Lathrix, and of course, welcome very briefly to the sandbox mode. Now, it's been quite a while since the last episode because I have been very busy upgrading the internals of the battleship and working on a brand new project. Now, the original intention was to have this project completely finished by the time the next episode was due to be uploaded, but, well, it turns out building a gigantic airship bigger than the battleship can be a little bit difficult when you actually want it to do fairly well. So this is going to be just a little teaser of the damaged battleship currently flying around, just making everything else look very, very small. The hull of the thing is actually very heavily based off the battleship, just it's a little bit thinner down the middle and has a bit more in the way of armor on the bottom and on the sides, just to make sure one shot won't down it from the skies entirely, along with a load of backup systems. But that's all we're going to be talking about that for today. As we're going to get back into the campaign, we're going to start out some more supply lines, actually finish them, and have a finished design for the supply carriers, in addition to upgrading the battleship a little bit more, and deciding what to do with this back section. I've really been turned off the idea of using drones, purely because they are not always spawned in with the battleship if the battleship is too low in force count in comparison to the enemy. So very likely we're either going to turn this into an extension of the missile launcher, which multiple of you ended up calling a toaster, and I agree fully, I have pretty much built a toaster on the back of this thing, or perhaps just some more turrets. Now I've upgraded them a little bit using some more of the, let's have a quick look, see what they're called, a few more of the manual autoloaders to attach to the high explosive pellets, just to make them a little bit more efficient at actually loading the shells. So, with that, let's get back into the campaign and see exactly what we're going to do. Also, should do some serious battling now I've gained a lot more land from the Onyx Watch. Back in the campaign, and before we actually start doing all the work I was just talking about, I want to make one difference to the campaign difficulty settings. From here on, we are going to be fighting much stronger designs, the godly designs. Now, the enemy were slowly ramping up and sending stronger and stronger enemies, but at this stage, I feel like we've outpaced them to such a high degree that even the fireworks are basically destroying every single attack coming from the Onyx Watch. But now, we should be fighting much, much scarier enemies. Things like the Bulwark are now very possible to be coming against us, now that we've been playing the campaign for X amount of hours. Also, you guys need to be destroyed. As usual, I've ended up being completely distracted. Whilst building the supply vehicles and actually making their final design, I've ended up upgrading the firework once again, and nothing too major, but now I've completely stripped all the old engine work from the centre of the vehicle, which was the very outdated engine which I was using basically as fuel storage, and made way for loads more of metal, natural, scrap and crystal storage, in addition to completely converting it to electrical power. No longer is it using any form of fuel engine, and because of this, it no longer uses up any fuel, and it's actually going significantly faster. The old version before this upgrade was going at 49 meters per second, sometimes a bit faster. Now it's going at a very smooth 68. Hopefully I will continue to upgrade it as time goes by, and perhaps I actually change the design itself, because now it's just a bit too small to really do much more unless we reconvert it back to fuel engines, which we may do in the future. First time being attacked since we claimed our new land, and sadly, it is indeed in the rain, so it is a little bit difficult to actually see what's going on. Against us, we have this thing, whatever the hell that is, in addition to, well, actually, I don't know what any of these ships are based on looks. I wish I'd looked on the map. Let's have a quick look-see. We are against the Palisade, the Lance, the Winter's Day, the Ironclad, and a Claymore. Well, that's a different set of things. Seems like us upping the difficulty is instantly taking an effect. That looks really cool. I love how they've done those rudders. Oh, incoming shots, and sadly bouncing through the shield there. It got deflected by one shield into the second. Our turret, though, still survived. Well done. EMP missiles, do your thing, please. And that ship there being bombarded by shells, sadly the lag causing the explosions not to show, otherwise we'd be on like maybe 3 frames per second. This is really well done. It's not that big, but it's definitely surviving extremely well. Oh, EMP turning off its main turret though, which is very good for us. How much damage have we taken? Not too much, and we are repairing. Our shields definitely are holding off the brunt of their attacks, including their advanced cannons. I am really happy with those shields, considering they're only like half powered currently. I want them to be strength 5, they're currently on strength 2.3, just for reference there. They're not that strong. It's just a lot of them, so they're mostly double layering. Oh, we flipped a ship! We have flipped a ship! And that one, by the looks of it, is either AI dead. Yep, AI dead indeed. So which one was that? That one was the Palisade or Palisade? I'm not sure how you pronounce that. I'm thinking Palisade. The bigger ship. One of our cannons has been damaged. It's currently shooting non-explosive rounds. Going to assume it's this one for some reason. Those missiles really are amazing. I am tempted to make a version of this battleship, take away all the cannons, just for laughs, and replace every single cannon set with missile launchers. I think it would be fantastic. I think it would actually be really effective. Just stupid. Poor thing. We could have captured these so easily, but I decided not to. I kind of just wanted to see the destruction, honestly. I will try and capture more in the future. People who follow me on Twitter will be aware that I've been working on a thruster craft that is completely reliant on player controls. It uses no AI whatsoever and only a few control blocks, just as a bit of a stabilizing force. That looks really cool. Onyx Watch designers, you are easily my favorite designers within From the Depths. Twin Guard looks amazing and really sci-fi. The Grey Talons look awesome. I'd say all factions look really awesome, but the Onyx Watch is just so close to my own building style, but done better. It really is. You appear to have a piece missing. Can you just finish this thing off, please? Here's the problem with using only EMP missiles, I suppose. We're not really doing any they aren't doing any damage. Oh, and we haven't actually updated this battleship to its new form, which has the more updated cannons. You know, the ones which actually load faster? So the explosion hurts more? Yeah. How are you still alive? Finally, 2 damage. That took forever. Well done for surviving just a brunt of attacks. Really does show, though, these cannons, as cool as they are, did need to be updated. Either way, that's 1 set of enemies destroyed. I think I may have wandered into their territory rather than going back to our resource zone. May have just been my fault, honestly. Okay, self-repair, pull out, and back to where you were going. Well, here we are then with the Float Line, a vehicle which a lot of you have pointed out is horribly inefficient, but I'm not actually going to be making any major changes, and I would like to explain exactly why that is. So first of all, a lot of you did say that if I removed the jet stabilizers, I could very easily have this simply on the always up fraction. However, I do not like using this under almost any circumstance. The fact is, it acts a little bit differently than some people seem to think it actually does. It doesn't try to right the vehicle in any way. All it's trying to do is it means that this block here, the original block, will always put its thrust towards the skies, always directly upwards, no matter how the rotor itself is angled. This doesn't always end up righting the machine and can have it going on its side, but still flying upwards, which can cause issues with the control blocks, especially if done in this fashion. Now, I'm not saying that will really happen with this particular vehicle. In fact, I'm almost certain it won't, as we can see, but it's just something I don't really wish to add to the vehicle. And actually, as we just saw there, for the very first time, the jet stabilizers actually fired off, and oh, since I've turned it onto always up, it's actually now rocking. It wasn't rocking before. So as we can see, it's actually now worse off now I've added that. The thing is though, because this is on the top, it will act as a self-writing mechanism for a while, at least to a very limited extent. It means if I attack by all the jet stabilizers, it won't ever flip over. This will not flip over because the center of mass is so securely underneath the center of lift. So with it always trying to push for lift upwards, it won't flip. It just means it's going to look like this. So it really is better, in my opinion, just to have the jet stabilizers now apparently in blue, because I haven't changed the color since messing around with the firework, and have it on a non-always up faction, or on a very low always up faction. As we can see, it's already slowing down, now I've done that, and if we just spawn it out and spawn it back in, it'll go back to being all lovely and stable and good in the world. There we are, all nice and clean. Except for the wrong color now, because derp de herp. You there, you there, you there, and you there. However, the one change I will be making, which is actually based off a lot of people's suggestions, is I'm going to be going ahead and adding, if I can find the darn thing, a repair tentacle. Just a single repair tentacle on the very bottom. This means we can have this vehicle basically making itself, and we don't even have to have it on show. So if we put the compact repair tentacle there, so now, if we build one of these, because it will be holding resource from the nearby fortress, we can have these building more of these, building more of these, so I don't have to build them all at one location and then send them out. We can simply build them on site. Now, when it comes to the battery usage, we could also have this on a much faster spin speed and simply use up no power is being used on them. However, I actually love the look of this kind of floating in place like this, rather than it being a clear sense of where it's getting its propulsion from. Having it float above the water, in my opinion, looks fairly cool. Now, I'm sure some people won't agree with that, but I personally do like it. So what we're going to do then is very quickly go ahead and save this as the float line, and then make some more as we go, and we can keep on putting them down all the way to the next resource zone, and then all the way onwards to the resource zone after that, and collect all the resources at one location. I could have the resources actually come back here and then use this as a building platform for all of our battleships and fireworks and all that good stuff in the future. So, onwards with the building, back in a second. Our northmost resource zone is now under attack, so let's see how the new fireworks can actually handle themselves. The missiles are now even more short range, but have more warheads to them, meaning they can deal a lot more damage. In addition to this, of course, they are now a lot faster, meaning they should be able to dodge regular cannon fire a little bit better. Okay, how are those missiles doing against us? They should be following the flares. Yes, they are. Their missiles are being made useless against us, only a couple actually hitting the target. And not really doing too much damage either. Very happy about that. Two shots incoming, and both of them missing. That was a pretty easy clear-up, honestly. That wasn't really much of a fight at all. EMP and 4-5 warhead, just regular damage missiles, pretty much cleared that up in just a couple of shots. Well done, fireworks, in your new glorious blue form. I think a rename may be needed at this stage, because they look so sci-fi-ish now that they're glowing blue. Still firing off flares, just in case. Well done, lads. Well done. Well, Athrix may have made a bit of a mistake, so I've accidentally sent our fireworks into a new tile rather than going back the way I was meant to send it. I've sent it like this. So we are now facing against a brand new enemy straight after the previous fight, and this is in the form of a Pioneer, which I have never seen before. I still can't pronounce that thing. And a Pinnacle. I believe the Pinnacle's quite a strong vehicle. If it's the one I remember, of course, it very well may not be. So as always, what we're going to do is spawn as close as possible to the enemy, so our missiles can get right in their faces straight away, and then just hope for the best. Okay, let's go on that one, and let's begin. Okay, the enemy have flares, but that's useless since we are using laser-designated weapons. the smallest of their vehicles getting hammered there and being instantly destroyed. I feel like the firework will always do well against very lightly armored opponents. It's just one of those vehicles that's almost all offense and no defense. So if we can destroy them quickly, we win. If it's a long drawn out battle, we lose. And against these smaller vehicles, I believe this is the Pinnacle? Or is that the Pioneer? That's the Pioneer. The Pinnacle is not the vehicle I thought it was. Okay, good to know. What am I thinking of then? Wow, that was lucky. I really can't remember. And the enemy is already sinking and taking a load more damage there. Already opening up the main weapon. Seems like all of its cannons are offline right now. Yep, all of the main cannons are offline. Of that one's still fighting, but has just taken a lot of EMP to the side. Both its shields just went down. And wow, that was a glorious hit. It seems like we're still fighting pretty small enemies, and the fireworks are very happy about this. I'm very happy about it as well. That little guy did quite a lot of damage though. The back section of the firework there is very badly damaged. So well done. You win a ribbon of some kind. Oh, I'm so happy the fireworks. Can you tell? I still love the fireworks. They're still my favourite vehicle and probably will be for all time. They are cheap, extremely aggressive, and just an absolute pleasure to use, since they even dodge each other mid-air so they never collide with each other. They're just really, really nice to use. So, one more tile is cleaned up, and oh, we have actually taken quite a bit of damage. Okay, you guys start repairing, if you can, which you should be. Why are you not repairing? What has caused that damage? I need to look this up, why they're not repairing. They do have repair bots. They don't have repair tentacles, but they do have repair bots, so I will have to look up what's causing that. Anyway, back to making loads upon loads of float lines. I found out what was causing the issue with the fireworks not repairing. It turns out several of the elements within the firework do actually use oil in their construction, so although I'm not using it for fuel, I will need some kind of oil storage just to make sure we can actually fully repair between battles. Thankfully, none of them had sustained any major damage. One of them was just under 80%, but they could all still fight, all still fly, so thankfully nothing really bad happened. But anyway, I'm currently here at our resource zone, which should be, if I turn on the UI, somewhere here, because I want to see if I can build something weird. Can a satellite harvest resource? Now, this is a little bit silly, and I do try to stay away from satellites as much as possible, but I do need a satellite anyway soon to start uncovering more of the map. I do need radars, and satellites obviously are a good fit there, so if I build a satellite, you know, all the way in space and all that good stuff, can we have it harvesting resources? Because that would be really, really cool. Now, sadly, I will have to build this in the sandbox mode, just because otherwise I'd have to get it into space to start building in space, because that's just how it works. It builds from where you are, not from where your camera is, even though once the vehicle has proven it's in space, you can keep it in space. So I could build something which could fly into space and then start building, but to make things a bit easier, let's just go over to the sandbox mode as a bit of a final thing to do today, because after this, it's just building and positioning float lines, so I've got a resource line all set up for lots and lots more vehicles. A change of plan. Now, we were going to go into the sandbox mode, but as soon as I cut the last clip, well, we were under attack by this lovely force. It seems like they sent a force against us long before we changed the difficulty. So here we are against the broadsiding forces of the Onyx Watch once more. But to make things worse, there's actually a force somewhere here, which I have no idea what's actually there. So currently two attacks against our fireworks, and you may notice we have only two fireworks currently in play because they outnumber us so much. So here's hoping we can be very victorious here with minor damage taken so that we can fight off the next enemy. In addition to all this, it turns out I was completely wrong when it came to building in space in the campaign. You can do it, and you can do it very, very easily, so that's what we'll be doing after the fight is over. Oh wow, oh no 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 no, if we get hit by a volley we are basically dead. What were you doing there? I'm guessing the fat firework may have lost one of its engines, it just stalled completely. Actually that wouldn't work because the fireworks have three separate engines. So no idea what happened to that one then. massive volley of shots, and by the looks of it, loads of internal damage and a huge chain effect going on, causing basically the whole inside then to blow up. Remember, these are basically the lowest difficulty Onyx Watch ships in this campaign. Oh, we're lagging out. Is it going to crash? No, it isn't. Thank you very much, game. I have a beastly computer setup, and I am still really looking forward to the day where this game is a little bit more optimized, but early games are early. Hey, level up. Hey, the third firework is in the battle with us. Excellent. For Zeench and all that good stuff. I mean, we are blue now, so Zeench is definitely more fitting than corn. A lot of people won't know what I'm talking about right now. But it's okay. Just smile and nod and everything will be better. All ignoring salvage? Yes, they are. Excellent. Just three more enemies left, and by the looks of it, that's already taken a lot of damage. And yes, a massive internal explosion there. That's why I love EMP. It's going through the metal into all the vital components, and boom. And then, of course, once again, we do have missiles with between 4 and 6 warheads, which, you know, big booms, lots of frag, explosions, happiness, death to the enemy. Enough resources to make many fireworks, if we captured one even more so, but the fireworks have no way to actually get out of the vehicle once you're in them, because they are not capturing vehicles. Once again, I am working on a player-controlled thruster craft to go along with my battleship and my fireworks for this very occasion. That will happen in the future. I feel like I'm kind of bullying these guys at this stage. They have such cool, powerful cannons, but against fast-moving targets, they just can't do anything. We just counter them. It's just a hard counter. It's nothing to do with one ship being better than the other. It's just one is better versus the other type. Once again, sadly, yes, the game did just crash. That is one of the dangers of running battles at maximum with maximum quality settings and then recording it. Because the game is not optimized at the moment, it can sometimes just, for no real reason, simply stop working. So I'm going to redo this fight if something weird happens, and then I'll cut back to it. Otherwise, we'll simply wait for the second enemy and see what they're bringing. The end of the first attack is near, so I've cut back just for a second because I did a little bit of research on the internet, you know, that weird thing people go to occasionally, and it turns out that missiles in particular that use a lot of warheads, especially either EMP or fragmentation, are known to cause an issue where the game can stutter and lag and then crash in the worst case scenario because of the sudden influx of so many particles which the game has to keep track of, once again, especially with the fragment kind. All of my missiles are between 4 and 6 warhead fragment missiles, with the exception of EMP, meaning that if a lot of missiles hit at the same time and the enemies spawn in at the same time as this, well, I think I've figured out what's causing all of the issues. Too many missiles, too big. But thankfully, this is pretty much over now. There's 3 enemies left, all 3 of the fireworks, I believe, are in good health, and once again, just showing that if you can counter an enemy vehicle type, you will normally win, even if yours are much, much smaller. Oh, almost hitting me. I do honestly believe, though, if we get hit by a whole volley, the firework will just drop out of the sky. It does not have enough armor to withstand a full broadside. I've seen what those things do to my supply vessel, which is quite heavily clad in armor. So hitting something made out of light metal alloy in addition to regular metal, it would just break apart. But until that happens, well, we can see right here in this still image. Well, a little bit surprising. It seems they are still sending rather small enemies against us. We have a Poseidon, a Faerday, and a Constitution. The Constitution is the ship we've been fighting, well, long before this, one of the larger of the broadsiding vehicles, which of course is based off the ship known as the Constitution in real life. So let's send in our Vehicle 4, also known as the Battleship, because thankfully the enemy can only move at 3 meters per second, so it's pretty easy just to run around them until the battleship gets here. Well done, fireworks. Cowardice and aggressiveness. The enemy fleet is even called the Relics of the Past. I think that really speaks for itself. It's kind of bizarre that now I'm seeing so many aggressive maneuvers by the Onyx Watch, all using the ships, which I haven't seen for a while, even before upping the difficulty. Kind of bizarre, but either way, let's get into this fight. It'd be lovely if they all actually spawn that way. Wait, are they actually going to spawn that way, all facing away from me? Because that means if I get nice and close like this, we're going to be able to broadside them as they move away from me. I'm okay with this. Bit of an advantage for the Lathraxian Legion here, honestly. Well, lads. Yeah, they are definitely facing away from me. This is going to be pretty brutal. Who are we firing at first, lads? This one, okay. Well, there we go, the first shells are hitting. Oh, there was so much damage. Our main shell went straight through the target. Well, there goes he. Which one was that? That was the Faerday. Which, now I think about it, is also a real ship. Oh, yeah. I didn't think about that when I first saw it. I'm just assuming everything's fake. I still haven't upgraded the sudden cannons. I know this because they're yellow. Yellow means low density. Red means high density. The higher density, the more explosive. That was just so unfair. I want the enemy to start sending the bulwarks and stuff against me. I want the larger vehicles to face off against ours. I can't wait until it happens, because right now it feels like that we have out-ramped the Onyx Watch. We have built bigger, and they haven't yet. I mean, at least the Constitution here did take a nice beating there and didn't instantly blow apart. Admittedly, I did just see a lot of EMP missiles go right inside there, so can only imagine a lot of things are offline. And leveling up again, because, well, we are going to be leveling up faster now because we have ramped up the enemy. The enemy design difficulty, even if we're not fighting it stronger designs yet. Have we taken any damage? We have taken, let's have a quick look-see, a little bit of damage, which we're actually healing faster than taking more of. We've lost less than 50 blocks. And so, seal clubbing in action. I love those missiles so much. Constant missile usage. Still need to upgrade the fortress. The fortress ship. Let's just call it that. The battleship. Thankfully, the game didn't crash that time. It just took a very long time to load in the defeat, because of course the enemy was then destroying itself. I need to figure out a way to stop the lag so much and to make this a bit more stable. What I think I'll simply have to do is lower the settings slightly, mostly in the weather settings. That should help out quite a bit, so next time that shouldn't happen again. At least, I hope so. One of the big issues as well is the enemy lower level ships, let's call them, the wooden ships, the historical ships, are actually really complex. A lot of weapons, a lot of AI, and a lot of block count makes just fighting them extremely laggy. You may have noticed versus the enemy metal ships, the larger vessels, I got pretty much no lag whatsoever, but versus these things, well, the game almost crashed twice today. Before we leave, though, for the episode, I do want to still test out if a satellite can harvest resource. Something to do with an orbital resource cannon just seems like a really silly, really awesome idea. So let's just see if we can at least get this working. If we can, then I am very tempted to make a giant orbital station for resource gathering, because that would be awesome. So we are now high enough, so what we're going to do is new objects, new vehicle, And there we are. We now have a floating block in the middle of space at an altitude of just under 1337. Oh, if we were just a little bit higher. Anyway, let's just see if we can get this thing working. Where are you? Processed resources, RTGs, let's just shove one of those on top. Again, we're just testing out if it works. This is not a permanent design. Don't worry, this would be incredibly boring. So then, processed resources, and we want resource gatherers. Oh, is that actually working? There is no raw storage. Oh yeah, that's a good thing we should really have. It's like a bizarre stick. Sure, it's a bizarre stick. Resources and natural resource storage. Yes, it works! It's actually gaining. Yes, it is! We now have some natural resource. Oh, that's awesome! Because, of course, just put natural there. Let's put a couple of misc instead. Wow. We are harvesting from space. That is absolutely mind-bogglingly awesome. Now, the one thing which won't work very well, I will say, is oil. Now, because the problem with that, in case you didn't know, is you don't actually gain oil until the bottom of this thing actually hits the bottom of the water. Although, never mind, it simply teleports down now. It was a bit weird in the past that you had to wait, which has been proven by some videos of me covering it, so never mind, that has clearly been changed at some point. That is really cool. And actually, with those, it looks like it's being tethered to the floor as if it could simply fly off. That's awesome. So with that, and with one final change, I have decided we are going to put the enemy growth factor all the way to 2, which means we're now getting 509% experience gain, which is pretty amazing. Although I don't really need levels anymore since I'm like level 400 myself, that's going to be really cool because this means the enemy will be attacking more often. In addition to that, it means they can outgrow their current phase of sending lower tier enemies against us and finally start sending the enemies which can definitely kill the fireworks and can pose a challenge, if not utterly destroy, the battleship, because that's what I want. I do love the fact that the fireworks are doing so well, being such low-cost vehicles, but at this stage, I want some more challenge, I want to be forced to build better, and at the moment, that's not happening. The battleship has inefficient cannons, but is just devastating enemies, and the fireworks really are harassment vehicles, but they're taking out whole fleets. Not actually what I want. So with that, thank you so much for watching. If you have enjoyed the video, then of course, likes, favorite, shares, comments, all that good stuff helps out me, helps out the channel, and most importantly, shows that From the Depths is a series you wish to see continued in the future. In the next episode, we will fully finish, finally, the supply lines. We will be working on this satellite, actually in campaign, which should be a nice change. And finally, I should hopefully be able to show some progress with the airship I've been building off camera. I'm really hoping that is going to be a viable vehicle for the future. Once again, thank you. And goodbye.